And I'm going to invite Ranjit Nair, who is CEO of Germinate. Ranjit, come on up. He's a computer scientist and entrepreneur, and he loves questions he can't answer, so ask a lot of questions. I'm not seeing the love. I'm not feeling the love, okay? We're not going to do a panel from start to finish. We're going to ask for questions in between, okay? So pay attention. I'd like to invite Krishnan Raman, who is founder and CEO of Flutura. Did I say that right?
Yeah.
Okay. And he's a new evolved specimen because he says he bleeds data, right? So this is Darwinism at work. And probably the most distinguished member of the panel, we've got Abhinav Shashank. Come on, Abhinav. Who's co-founder and CEO of Innovacer. Now, he's 26 years old, and he's figured out how to change the world using data. Okay, so we've got three very interesting folks. I'm not going to talk about myself. It's these guys. Okay? And welcome. Ready?
Yep.
All right. Thank you. That's right. Get the energy up. Okay, you can sit down if you want. I'm going to stand up. So I thought we'd start off with a softball question, right? I get a lot of questions about what is big data? And it feels like it's, you know, the blind man and the big elephant, right? Depends on what part you're looking at. And so I'm going to turn this question over to each one of them. They're going to tell you how they think about big data, okay? Krishnan, you want to get started?
Sure, I can.
Speak up.
Is there a mic?
Or should I really pump
up? You can use this.
Yeah, you should pump up your energy.
Too much.
Thank you. Just wanted to actually start off with something that happened in Texas. Just wanted to do a quick check. How many of you have been to Texas? Well, that's an awesome lot. Fantastic. So I was doing a big data workshop in Texas, and at the end of it, there is this guy, actually huge Texan. I'm sure actually many of you would have seen them. Huge Texan who just walked over to me, put his hand around me. I was looking at him like this and said, Sonny, in Texas, we just call it data. Everything is big. Okay, so to me, if you really ask me, big data is exactly that. And I need to be thankful to McKinsey, though I don't like it. I don't use the term big data at all. I need to be thankful to McKinsey for actually making it popular by going ahead and actually calling it and doing it something. To me, it is about how you can improve business performance, be it in whatever actually you are going ahead and doing. And let me take in terms of this thing. I'm sure actually the panel will have multiple views on it. Let me start off with this in terms of actually one area where we have been spending a lot of time on and thinking. Just imagine, again, actually a question to you. Let me actually figure out in terms of how much you know. What was special about year 2008? Financial crisis. Yeah. Lehman is what actually everybody goes ahead and talks about. There is a silent fact that happened in that year, which is the number of machines or devices connected to the internet exceeded the world population. Roll back 10 years, in 2003, we are talking about actually probably 500 million devices connected to the internet. And in 2008, it exceeded 6 billion. Whatever estimates go on now, we are talking about actually something close to around actually 14 billion and continuously climbing. Expected to touch. Again, I wanted to ask you something in terms of what happened before 90s? Sanjay was there.
I am that old.
So Sanjay was there, and Sanjay was definitely making machines, but they were not connected. They were not connected at that point in time. And came to the 90s, internet went ahead and revolutionized it because the machines got connected. Today, we are in an era, and which is the reason why I'm saying it is because we are focused on that, is where all the various variety of systems that are there, the machines that are there, they are getting connected. and machines are going to talk. This is what you will call as actually the industrial IoT, industrial Internet of Things, or whatever actually you want to go ahead and call it. So my wife was asking me this, and I told, he was asking, actually, what do you do? So I said, actually, I listen to machines. So she said, okay, do you do that? So I said, yeah, machines have always been like you. They always talk, but we have not been listening. So now we have started actually listening to it, and that's actually one thing where data in large volumes is going ahead and impacting, and there is actually business use cases. Maybe we'll touch upon it actually a little later.
Great. So Ranjit?
Yeah. So what do I think about big data? I don't think about big data a whole lot. We've always been focused on the business problems that we're trying to solve, and we've been working on with large volumes of data. In our case, it's social media data. Before the term big data was even popular. We can thank McKinsey for making the big data term popular, and we do enjoy the hype. It helps us talk to customers, but we also face the negative, the opposite side of it, where the question we get asked and we don't like being asked is, do you guys do big data? And I don't do big data, right? I try to solve customers' problems. It's in some sense, this hype around big data is explained by the promise that this field is going to deliver, the value that we expect it to deliver. But we've not even scratched the surface, and I hate to say this, but I don't think we've done justice to that potential that exists. It's almost like that emperor that doesn't wear clothes. I'm not going to go to the extent of saying that. I think it's the emperor is wearing a very skimpy bikini that's barely covering his unmentionables. Today, I would like to spend some time later on talking about actual business problems that we have tried to solve that fall in the realm of big data.
Great. Abhinav?
Sure. So I think what I would consider as big data is that I think over the past 20, 25 years, the industry actually spent quite a large amount of effort and energy into setting up infrastructure and setting up IT systems to actually capture a whole lot of what's happening in their businesses. And today, I think over the past couple of years or 3 years, what's really happened is that people have started realizing that we have this huge chunks of data. We've been capturing all the data that there is, and there is like a lot of value that we can actually generate out of it. And it's not just businesses, it's you and me as consumers as well. A large part of what we are making our decisions today has actually become more data-driven than ever. I think where we shop, what we essentially go ahead and eat, all these use cases are essentially driven by more data than ever, essentially. And from that perspective, I think the term big data is really to describe the evolution of IT and the internet, essentially, over the past 20 years or so. And all this data now coming into a place where technology has evolved to an extent where we can make sense out of it, and we can actionably do things basis these data sets that we've been curating over such a large part of time. So I think that's what, according to us, is big data, and that's where I think a lot of the effort and energy would go on, where machines will really help us make decisions and become more smarter over time. And I think that's the real value of big data, and that's what big data is, at least according to us.
That's great. Don't go away.
Okay.
What is your absolute most favorite use case that you worked on personally? Can you talk a little bit about that?
Okay. So as a company, we are essentially working with researchers across the world as in, trying to solve their challenges on structured data. Because a lot of the data that's being produced today is in such unstructured way that if you really want to do any analysis on top of it, it becomes really, really challenging. So we work with a lot with researchers in terms of helping them get structure out of data and really solving some of the challenges. So I'll talk of a particular instance where we're working with a researcher at MIT who is trying to develop a recommender system for apps. Now, there are million plus apps today. And if I ask probably any one of you today, what are the kind of apps that you would want to use out of this million? I doubt that there would be any one of us who would know what are the best apps that would make us more productive. There is huge amount of data. Developers have been putting amazing amount of effort into developing these apps. But are we as consumers, do we really know what are the kind of apps that are suited best for me as an individual? So combining what you've essentially said on social media, what you've, who you are as an individual on the internet today, and really making a recommendation to you, saying that this is the app that you should go ahead and use, and these are the 10 apps if you use, your productivity would increase by 20%. That's really the value that I think we kind of generated, and I'm talking of more of business to consumer side of it, so that every one of us can actually relate to it. There are obviously a lot of these implications that go on to the business side as well, but actually predicting something of this sort really makes it very, very exciting that a machine can now tell me how I can be 20% more predictive. And that's really the power of big data today, and I think it's just going to enhance with a lot of effort that we are actually putting in as a community today on the big data.
That's great. Yeah. Do you guys, one of you want to take it up next?
Sure, I'll take a slightly different example. So this is for a customer, we're allowed to name them. So this is for MTV. How many of you guys have watched the show Coke Studio? Oh, fantastic. Okay, so this goes back to season one of Coke Studio, when the show had already begun. They had already done about 6 weeks of marketing before the show launched. And they wanted to understand whether the show was doing well, what aspects of the show people liked, how it compared to Coke Studio Pakistan, how it compared to Coke Studio in, to Coke Studio in Brazil. And they wanted to understand what aspects of the show people liked, what they didn't like, which singers did people like, which singers they did not like, what whether there were certain perceptions around the show that had been built up before the show actually launched, and whether those perceptions held even after the show was actually after the show aired. And using our solution, they were able to first of all gather all these conversations that were happening across disparate sites, over a million different sites where conversations were happening, picked up the relevant ones to Coke Studio India and these other and the two competitors, understand what aspects of the show people actually could associate with. So there was a lot of people who thought it was going to have a huge Bollywood theme, and they didn't like that. There were people who complained about the sound quality, that every song sounded the same regardless of which episode it was in. And they were able to actually distill these insights, and they were able to use it for leverage it for the next season. So season one, their TRPs weren't that strong. Season two, what they realized was that, you know what, instead of one music director, we're going to have 8 music directors. So this is human insight, but it came from the fact that the data was telling them that every song sounded the same. They were then able to change various aspects of the show, including, so they largely driven from insights that came from our tool. But of course, there were a lot of other things that they did, and we can't attribute all their success to these insights. But nevertheless, season two and season three had much, much better TRPs. So if you're looking at it purely from an economic sense, this is an example of how big this analysis of these conversations actually resulted in value being gained by the company in particular.
Great. Krishna?
Okay. Now, in fact, actually, Renjith was talking about economic value. Let me give you one example. How many of you know about the Gulf of Mexico incident that happened out of Texas? Any idea in terms of the economic impact of that?
$1 trillion.
Less than that. See, it was about what is actually the public, this is all public knowledge. I don't have anything connected with BP per se. But it's about actually $42 billion. And 4 weeks back, when I was in Houston, they were found to be actually some willful default ruling or whatever, another $18 billion. Okay, now this is one part. Again, another publicly available information is the fact saying that the day this entire event happened, okay, that day they were supposed to be awarded for the most safest performance. Now just imagine, what 42 plus 18, 60. $60 billion event that is happening. And the day that happened, you are going to be awarded actually probably for the safest performance. It's nothing to do with the company per se. I'm more talking about actually the fact on the table.
could this have been prevented? The reason why they were awarded, they were going to be awarded, was because of actually a one critical metric called days since the last accident. What if instead of a rear view mirror, we had a forward looking view? What if all those machines that are there around were able to talk, were able to provide you those leading indicators that are required? We could have actually avoided the $60 billion disaster. That is something today, with technology, as well as actually with the various focused solutions related to safety, that you can go ahead and focus on. This is an impacting use case.
That's great. Three different types of cases. As promised, you get to ask questions. Anybody have a question? Mike over there. Here you go. You can address it to anyone or to the whole panel.
Yeah, I think I'll address to everyone. So I believe still we are at the early days of understanding big data. It's all unstructured. We are having algorithms running behind to interpret that data. Now, the question is, people are trying to catch a wave, right? But how much validation exists in the system that the current algos to interpret this unstructured data is actually there? I mean, do we have enough big data to say that these algos actually work, right? And how many years it will take to actually prove that these algos actually work? A company who has blown like $500 million in implementing a big data analytics obviously will not go and say it doesn't work. It works 40% of time, which probably my my foreteller will also tell me that this is how it works. So how do we build a case, a compelling case, having enough data to prove that big data and the algorithms which are helping us interpret those unstructured data sets today are effective enough for people to adopt and for everybody, not just the guys who have the money power to invest in?
Shall I? The answer, the first answer is that actually, how many of you go ahead and look at it in terms of utilizing Google today? Raise of hands. See, today, whenever I need to commute from one place to another, the first thing that I go to is actually I go to my smartphone and look at it in terms of actually what is the time I'm going to take. And Google kind of actually goes ahead and gives you an indication. Is it accurate? You could be 10 minutes this way, that way, but you get an indication. See, the interesting thing about analytics, and like what Sanjay said, actually, I bleed data because last 15 years, that's what we have been dealing with on this. So interesting thing about analytics especially, we are not talking about actually financial numbers out here. It is about speed of decision making. So if you have certain, I'll give you an example, actually, another one of our customers, actually, where we have gone ahead and done work with. There is, we were dealing with something called a trip unit. So if you look into this building, I'm sure actually there are those trip units where it kind of goes ahead and trips if something bad is happening. For large power situations, if something wrong happens, there is something called an arc flash that happens, and that entire area gets erased. Whatever our customer has actually shared with us, close to around 1,000 such incidents happen every year in US and Canada alone, those explosions, leading to a lot of collateral damage, lot of burns that happen, and close to around 300 to 400 lives being lost. What we went ahead and did was analyze the 348 parameters that that particular unit emanates every 10 seconds, harnessed it, and we said, actually, we don't want to play God. What we will do is we will go ahead and project and predict in advance. The first thing that I go to is actually I go to my smartphone and look at it in terms of actually what is the time I'm going to take. And Google kind of actually goes ahead and gives you an indication. Is it accurate? You could be 10 minutes this way, that way, but you get an indication. See, the interesting thing about analytics, and like what Sanjay said, actually, I bleed data because last 15 years, that's what we have been dealing with on this. So interesting thing about analytics especially, we are not talking about actually financial numbers out here. It is about speed of decision making. So if you have certain, I'll give you an example, actually another one of our customers actually where we have gone ahead and done work with. There is, we were dealing with something called a trip unit. So if you look into this building, I'm sure actually there are those trip units where it kind of goes ahead and trips if something bad is happening. For large power situations, if something wrong happens, there is something called an arc flash that happens, and that entire area gets erased. Whatever our customer has actually shared with us, close to around 1,000 such incidents happen every year in US and Canada alone, those explosions, leading to a lot of collateral damage, lot of burns that happen, and close to around 300 to 400 lives being lost. What we went ahead and did was analyze the 348 parameters that that particular unit emanates every 10 seconds, harnessed it, and we said, actually, we don't want to play God. What we will do is we will go ahead and project and predict in advance deterioration in performance. 6 months before, it's better to replace that unit, even if it is probably going to go ahead and actually live for another year, than actually lose a life. So if you really ask me, the way to look at it is in terms of actually many times, roughly right is better than actually being precisely wrong. So the way to look at it is in terms of actually how to go ahead and.
Ranjit, you want to take a whack?
So let me answer this question in two parts. So firstly, to answer the question from a more technical perspective, you have historical data, and so you could have always turned the numbers against that data, seen what this decision was recommended, and seen whether how close that decision was actually to what was actually done on the ground. So you're basically you have all that historical data. See whether predictions that were made, recommendations were made, would have turned out to be even better than what was actually done. But leaving that aside, in many cases, you're trying to get directionally correct answers. And in such cases, as long as your analysis is directionally correct, in most applications, it's not going to be the difference between a 30% getting the answer 30% correct versus someone saying it's 35%. It really doesn't matter that much. I would also go to the extent of saying that agreeing with Krishnan's point that you need to, what you're trying to do is get an answer very quickly. So as long as you're able to get an answer which is directionally correct in a quick manner, I think that's what the job is half done there.
Abhinav, you want to take a shot or should we take other questions?
Sure.
Yeah, let's take other questions. Any questions? Yes, sir.
See, we have spoken that we are in the early days of the big data journey. As companies who have paying customers, I just want to understand from you, what is the engagement model you are seeing with your customers? Are they willing to invest on the software? Are they looking at services and outcome-based? You know, where are you seeing the engagement happening? In which model?
So we have two models that work for us. One is with the more mature customers who are perfectly capable of doing it in a do-it-yourself model. So they use our product, they've been trained in the product, they're able to configure it themselves, run the algorithm that they need, and they're able to come up with the analysis that they require. The other model is more of a product plus professional services model, where they pay us a product subscription fee, and they use our data scientists to actually help them get the answers that they need. So it's a combination of the two, and we found that sometimes companies start with needing professional services, and then they develop enough internal proficiency to start doing it on their own.
Abhinav?
Yeah.
Here.
So I think from our perspective, what we've essentially seen is that it depends a lot on who the customer is. And I think there are majorly going, there are two models, essentially, if you're looking at it. So one, as Ranjit said, the first one is essentially the professional services model, and the second is essentially the SaaS model. So there are some problems that customers are facing at, and businesses are essentially facing at this point of time, that can be generalized across a wide variety of these customer bases. And in these customer bases, and some of our products that we are essentially looking at are SaaS models, where people are actually putting in their own data and then drawing out insights. And these are same problems that all other businesses are essentially facing. So we are looking at solving problems at scale in some of these cases, but some of these problems that are very, very specific to a particular customer. And in those cases, typically the services model is obviously going to work, and a wide variety of these businesses are trying to figure out what are their use cases. And therefore, a lot of these customers that we are essentially dealing with start off with saying that, okay, this is my particular problem, can you essentially go ahead and solve it? And in some cases, we are actually able to put the product in and say that, okay, this is the problem, you can essentially go ahead and solve it in this particular way. But a lot of customers that are essentially looking at big data, because it's in such early stage at this point of time, they really want to figure out that, can you go ahead and solve it specifically for us? So I think it's pretty much a combination of professional services and a SaaS model that pretty much existent at this point of time.
That's practical. Good advice.
So there's no mention of big data on our website or in any of our presentations. We solve a particular problem. Those problems are not going to go away. The fact that the data exists in large volumes is not going to go away. And the ways we solve those problems might change, but as long as we continue to deliver value, we're not really concerned about this bubble bursting.
Krishna?
Sanjay, what is big data? Absolutely, whatever Ranjit was saying, the core business problem will not move. There are these philosophies actually that happens. In fact, actually, like I said, I've been dealing with data for a long time. Not sure how many of you are from the data warehousing era. So late 90s, people used to go ahead and talk about it on, I don't know what the value is, but I will go ahead and put all the data in an enterprise data model, put it all together, and then somebody will derive value. There are a lot of people who are going ahead and looking at big data from that angle. And in my mind, that won't work. You need to be deep and agile. So you need to be sharply focused on those use cases which are of business value, which can actually then be delivering value. It doesn't matter actually whether it is big data, small data. Let me ask you this question. There was the entire hurricane, I forget the name, hurricane that happened actually in New York. It kind of actually brought Manhattan down. So Manhattan down. So there were two things that they did. One was, there was a bunch of people who went ahead and looked at it on collating all tweets emanating from the affected areas to figure out which was the area which was affected the most. And there was another bunch of guys who went ahead and actually did a telephonic survey. The first one was actually about something close to around actually a few million tweets that they analyzed. The second one was actually a 3,000 people telephone call, whatever actually mechanism they could reach out into. Any idea which one actually gave the better results? Why? There were two reasons actually why it happened. One, most of the places which were really affected, if you go ahead and do a demographic analysis, they were aged population. They were people who were not using smart data. The second reason was, wherever it was extremely severely affected, the damn telephone towers themselves were down and nobody was actually tweeting from that area. So it doesn't matter, actually, big or small doesn't matter. What matters is business value.
Cool. Any final question? Or are we done?
It's okay. We have again.
Three more minutes. Just ask a small question, not a big question.
Okay. Fine. So you guys don't need to worry about what is going to happen to you. if big data is not there, even though you don't say big data, right? I want to understand, like, this is like very start. A lot of people are not using. Some people are trying. The people who are having a lot of money, like organization, they have some regulatory purpose. They need to do some analysis or something because they are financial institutions. There are one of the example you guys have given and previous speakers has given, more focused on the retail, is basically forecasting the purchasing behavior and other things. What do you think, with your experience in so many years into this particular big data, which sector you think which is like coming up front and trying to do and accept this particular big data analytics and do the analytics? Which sector? Healthcare, financial, or security? Or
okay, here's a challenge. You only have one word. It's a one-word answer to this question. Okay? So think about it. One-word answer to the question.
One-word answer? Well, okay.
Two words, maybe.
So for me, it's simple. It's consumer-facing businesses.
Three words, not too bad.
Finance and healthcare.
Three words. Krishnan, you got to beat these two.
Utilities, oil and gas. The reason is we are focused there.
All right. Thank you very much. We're out of time. I want you to, you know, a special clap for Abhinav. This is his first panel. He was very nervous. You did great.
Thank you so much.